So I am continuing my field test for the Sakura Koi watercolor markers, and this is the dry field test. It's on fluid cold press watercolor paper. This is a wood pulp based watercolor paper. In my prior video, I was working on Fabriano cotton based paper, and I posited that some of the problems I was having was due to just like the differences between a wood pulp based paper and a cotton based paper. So I am doing a dry test on a wood pulp based paper. Sorry, I'm trying to like clear hairs and stuff before I start getting down to it. So I'm not 100% sure how this is gonna turn out, how good this is gonna look. But we'll find out together. It seems like I've been failing on camera a lot lately, which isn't my favorite thing to do. But I mean, at least you guys, I mean, I feel like failing on camera is better than only succeeding on camera, because it gives a more well-rounded look. Inside look, scoop, as to what a lot of artists actually do go through in terms of like creation and I don't want to say failure, because if you learned something, it's not a failure, but not everything you do is going to turn out super amazing, so you just have to learn to roll with it, discard it. So I am going to be blending with the Sakura Koi, the blending pen for it, and already, I mean, it's a very juicy blending pen, but there is some scrubbing on the paper, which is a no-no for water-based markers that are meant to be used without water. And I think these are meant to go either way, especially if you're using their brush to blend. And the way the brush this blends is, it's not like watercolors in that it will pull your color into an area that doesn't have color. It's more like alcohol based markers, where it seems like it's kind of pushing the color away somewhat. And I'm using a modification of a technique I mentioned. I didn't come up with it. It's a pretty common technique, but a technique I'd mentioned in one of my many water-based marker blog posts on natosoup.blogspot.com, where you color in the shadows so that it's not like this overwhelming, intense color. And I already have a problem. That's not gonna focus. There we go. Right here, where the blender marker, it pulled some of the Mitsuo Aida ink. It smudged. Even though I have been very careful in erasing this, because I know if you leave graphite on the paper, that can cause smudging problems. So I try to be very, very careful about erasing. And sometimes if a marker, I mean, this isn't even a dry marker, this is a very wet blender marker, which is fine. It pulled right there. And I think I actually had minor skin smearing, smudging problems with the Up and Up marker review, the field test, which is in my queue right now. It should be up in December, for those of you who are curious about more store brand watercolor markers, washable markers. They had a minor problem with smudging in the beginning, and you wouldn't have been able to tell. Oh, I'm gonna pull out a little bit more there. Okay, so I'm actually liking how they're blending now that I'm a little more used to them. I'm probably gonna have to get a paper towel at some point to clean it. I'm going to make an assumption that the blender liquid is water and glycerin, because I don't know if you know what water-based markers use as a blending fluid. I would really, 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 really like to know, because I am very curious about that. And if you know, like, if different brands use different mixtures or whatever, I would like to know that too. Always very interested in that. So I'm coloring Kara's skin in with Naples Yellow, which is kind of too yellow for her skin, but it's the best thing I have. I'd ordered my skin tones open stock because I'd ordered a 12 pack using that as like a approximation, thinking it was going to be a decent skin tone, and it's very, very pink. Or is it? No, it's light. It's very orange. It's not even pink. It's like, it's really not a good skin tone. And this one isn't either. As you build it up, you can see how yellow, Naples Yellow, quickly becomes. And as I mentioned in my other video, that's just one of the problems, unfortunately, with buying stuff open stock online. And I didn't really have a lot of options for buying these open stock or in a set, because I think I got my 12 pack from either JetPens or Amazon a little while back to augment some markers that I'd bought individually back when JetPens offered them open stock, and they don't anymore. So I had to kind of search around for a place to order more markers, and I actually got them on the Sakura website, so you can't see this, but I'm checking my swatch book as well for color accuracy. That's not an unreasonable thing. So I'm adding some pink to Kara's skin with coral red, which is not red at all. It's a very fair light pink, almost a skin tone, a good blush. Unfortunately, and I may have to just like step away and let them dry because it's not layering the way I'd hoped it would layer. And I'm also getting some scrubbing now, so these definitely need to be allowed to dry some, I think, is part of the problem. So I'll lay in this initial application, and then I'll pause the video and let it dry. So that's a consideration. Something about the Up and Up markers that I did review a little while ago is that they're really incredible for water-based markers in that you can pretty much layer them almost immediately. I think anybody who uses water-based markers regularly without using them as a watercolor substitute knows how impressive that is as a feat. Okay, so I'm gonna leave her skin alone for a little while and let it dry so I can better layer. And I'm gonna start coloring in her dress. And I actually didn't pick my colors ahead of time, which is unusual for me. So I think her bow and the shoulder things are going to be salmon pink, which is kind of an intense pink. And I'm trying to decide if I love spring green, fresh green, sap green. It's like one of my favorite colors. I'm just trying to decide if I want to use this bright green and I guess color in the shadow with yellow green. And if that should work. And then maybe salmon pink is like a really red, it's more like a coral than coral red, which was a pink. So what I ought to do is put my first layer of the dress in coral pink and then do the shadows in coral red, and then do the shadows in, yeah, sorry. Yeah, I think so. Actually, let me show you this. So that pink, that peach, this one, pale orange, it is not as I remembered it. It is like a very light, almost fluorescent pink. which makes it hard to use as a skin tone. And Naples yellow, when you add enough water, and woody brown too, when you add enough water, are both very nice skin tones. But I'm trying to do a dry application, and as you can see, her skin is like kind of day glow. It's like more day glow here in person than the camera is catching. And I'll try to kind of blend that out a little bit. That is like a fake tan. That is intense. And I mean, when I drew this image, when I decided I was gonna like retest these markers, I knew that this was something that could be a possibility. So I'm not complaining. It's just something to be aware of, that Naples yellow builds up very quickly into a very strong color. Like, you really have to water it down. But I mean, it's all a learning process. I also have a rose red, which is pretty, but I don't know if that is really a good color for this. So last weekend, or weekend before last, honestly, I went to New Orleans for Nokas Fest. I think I was talking about it in a few of my other videos. And honestly, by the time these are uploaded into my YouTube, it will be months past. But I had a really, really good time. It's a one-day show in New Orleans. It's a comic show. So it's like a lot of indie comics and zines and people who self-publish. So what I do. My mom and brother came to help me because I was staying with family to help kind of defray costs, because it's a one-day show, so it's not really much of an opportunity. Even if it goes super well, there isn't really a whole lot of opportunity to make back like your airfare costs and your hotel costs and your food costs. So I stay with family because they live like 40 minutes out, and I kind of just use it as an excuse to visit family. And they come and they help me with the show, which I appreciate. Because, you know, it's nice to be able to see people you don't see often. And it's nice to have the extra hands, too. So I'm going to try blue. Oh, yeah, here we go. This is where the magic happens. When you're using a color to blend another color. This reminds me a lot of those Up and Up markers, which I really liked. They're a little bit cheaper than these, but these have a brush tip that is actually a brush tip. I mean, it's not the softest brush tip or the most flexible, but it is a brush tip. So that's cool. I'm happy about that. Anyway, Nokas Fest was great. And if you live in the South, or if you're thinking about it, if you're looking for like another IndieCon, I think you should go, because I'll be there and we can hang out and talk about comics or art supplies. And the people were really cool, and it's New Orleans, so the food is great, and everyone is, for the most part, friendly, as long as you're not, like, as long as you don't make a jerk out of yourself, you should be okay. And you do a little bit of research ahead of time so you know what you want to do with your time there. Because there's so much to do in Louisiana, though not necessarily so much to do comics-wise. And while I was there, I met this other Rebecca, who is a Rebecca, not a Becca, like I'm a Becca. She and some other women are doing this shop down on, it's a part of town I never go into. There's nothing wrong with it, it's just, I'm from like Podunk, Louisiana, and this is kind of like the nicer part of New Orleans. So when I say I don't go there, it's not an insult. It's just my family doesn't always have business down there. And it ends with the end of November, so I really need to like tweet about it more so people will go check it out. But it's really cool. It features a lot of like local New Orleans women who make things, right? And like, one of my big complaints about Louisiana crafts, Louisiana art, is that for the most part, it's very the same. You know, like, I went to a the Fall Fest at Destrehan Plantation, and it was like a bunch of like woodburn Disney knockoff things, right? So it's like that kind of thing where like someone has clearly learned a skill, but they don't have any creativity. This shop is the opposite of that. It's all this beautiful, well thought out stuff. And in Louisiana, women get paid about 66% of what men get paid. So what the store does is they charge female customers 66% of the full price, which I think is great, because it always seems like everything just costs so much more. So it's hard to explain. But they asked if I'd like to put some of my stuff in the shop. So the shop has some of my sassy buttons, and it's got copies of Kara, and it's got copies of Chainmail Bikini, which is a game anthology, a lady game anthology that I'm part of. And it's got most of my minis for this year. So it's got Favorite Fictional Femmes, which is my new mini, and it has Magical Girl March. Sorry, I had like a big brain fart. Magical Girl March, and I don't think it's got the Japan book, but it's got my Ashcan for this year. I mean, 2014-2015 Ashcan. And oh, charms. They've got a bunch of my charms as well. So if you like my stuff, oh, and pretty much all of the prices I gave them are my convention prices. So if you like my stuff and you don't want to pay shipping and you'd like to support me, because I actually get a cut of those sales, and you know, like, you should go check it out, and I'll be tweeting about it lots more, because it's like really crummy of me to talk about this thing and not have like an annotation or anything. But I think you should check it out, because there's a lot of really, really well-made stuff, and there's some zines in there. If you like zines, I like zines. I didn't get much of a chance to walk around and buy at Noka's, so I bought a lot of zines at, I definitely prefer comics over zines, but that's, comics is what I really do. Not so much zines. But it was mostly zines, and I bought a lot of zines, and I bought some jewelry, and I bought my mom a nice scarf that someone had made on a loom, which is just the coolest thing, and I can't wait until chapter 6 is, like, rolling, because Kara's mom is a seamstress, but she does all of these other, like, cloth weaving kind of things to help ends meet in their family. So, like, I think weaving is super cool. Yeah, I had a good time at Noka's Fest. I wish I could have left the table more. It always starts out like every show. I kind of start with an anxiety attack. Like, I'm not good enough to be here. I'm just this woman with like this really anime style, and nobody likes that. And I do kids comics, and it's so much easier to sell kids comics if you have a publisher behind you, and all, you know, like a billion like little anxious thoughts that just kind of hurt you instead of helping you get better at what you're doing. So like, I spent the first half of the show kind of antsy, and then the second half I was really into it, but sales were going really well, and it's hard sometimes for me to trust other people with my table. It's my mom, she's not gonna steal, that wasn't what I thought. It was just there's a lot going on, and the conversation is a big part of it. So maybe next year I can get up and like go chat with people. I would love to have Joseph come with me one year and do artist interviews, because like that is the show, that and Handmade and Bound in Nashville would be like the shows that could really, really benefit from their artists getting a second platform for a voice, because the New Orleans and the Nashville comic scenes are really kind of small right now. And I'm meeting, like, new Nashville artists, like, all the time. But it's still small and kind of disjointed. And so just something like that, I think, could be really cool. There's, like, no way I could ask my mom to do interviews, because She's kind of a shy person too, and my younger brother is even shyer than both of us. That would just not work. But yeah, I am excited. I feel like I've hit a point with conventions this year. I've doing way fewer of them, but I am having a much better time at the shows I do choose to do. And sales are better, and I just, like, I mean, my real only complaint about shows this year is that when, like, Joseph talks to people, or my mom and brother go talk to people, they mention that they're familiar with my blog, or, like, I taught them how to panel, or, you know, stuff like that, but they don't ever come talk to me, and that is really, oh, that's so Christmassy. That's such a bummer for me, because it's, like, the whole point of doing these things is so I can, well, make a living, and also because I love it, but the reason I teach people and I offer this stuff for free is so I can kind of help form a community, do my part to improve comics as a whole. Because that's something I feel really strongly about. I'm really passionate about it. And when people don't come say hi, I don't get to partake in that, you know? So if you're one of my watchers, and you're wondering if you should come say hi to me at a show, the answer is yes, you should. And if I look busy, I'm really sorry. Just be patient, because I do really want to talk to you. It really would mean a lot to me. And I don't bite, and I'm really shy too, and I'm bad about getting back to emails, but I'm a lot better in person. For some reason, online stuff sometimes gives me anxiety. Yeah, if that's, like, a thing you were thinking about because you read my blog or you watch my channel, you should definitely come say hi to me. I don't bite at all. I'm actually kind of a nice person sometimes. To you guys, always. To other people, it depends. These are really, now that this is going, and I probably keep taking it off camera, so I'm going to pull out even more. Now that this thing is going, it remind me of the up and up markers, but I like that. Like, I'm not complaining about that. I don't have a problem with that. If you're having, and I actually went to Target to buy my mom some of the up and up markers, because she likes to do coloring books. And I think I talked to you guys about my mom doing coloring books. She likes to do coloring books, and I've also talked to you guys about, like, wanting to encourage that, right? Because, like, I'm an art supply pusher. I have to share these things that I love with other people, because, like, what's the point of all the money that gets spent buying the supplies and all the time that gets spent learning how to do something if you can't share it with somebody else? And I really like the up and up markers, and I thought she would really like them, and they're very affordable. So there isn't really, like, if you know they're a good thing, there's not really a good reason not to give them a shot, right? And I went to Target so I could buy her a pack, and I can't find the super tip ones now, which are the ones I like. I didn't test their normal for kids ones. I have no idea if those are any good. And I don't really want to find out either. I did a test with the Crayola multicultural markers not too long ago, and you know, like, they just didn't perform as well as, like, the super tips did. So I'm kind of, given the similarities between the brands, I'm kind of assuming it's going to be the same thing. However, if you've used Up and Up's non super tips and they're even better than their super tips, you should let me know, and I will revisit that idea, and I'll test them out. So, these blend pretty well on the watercolor paper. They move well, which is something some watercolor markers that are intended to be watercolor markers, like Winsor & Newton watercolor markers, they don't do it as well as these do on dry paper. So that's pretty cool. And I ended up accidentally making this look kind of Christmas. Pink and green are some of my favorite colors. But I really like them. My paper is a little damp from how much ink I've been putting down, because these aren't alcohol based, so the ink isn't going to just evaporate for you right away. It does take a minute. And then my nib's a little bit dirty. I have another one I could use, but I'm not going to do that. So I'm going to try to apply some freckles using dark. Do I want to use dark brown for freckles, or do I want to use, I think I want to use woody brown for freckles, because I was doing woody brown to kind of tone down some of these. Oh yeah, that's right. I really don't have a good shadow color, a good shade color that will bring, I guess Bordeaux is okay. Which one's Bordeaux? Is this it? Yeah, this is Bordeaux. This is Bordeaux. You wouldn't guess it by the cap, because cap is like fuchsia or purple, but. And I need to be really light-handed with this because this is a super intense purple. And it might actually, oh, it's peeling the paper. I overworked this. So that's something to keep in mind with these markers, is you can overwork the paper. And when that starts to happen, you can tell because the paper fibers want to move around. I'll zoom in. Hopefully you guys can see. See on her neck, the paper fibers start to move around a little bit as you scrub to move the color around. And if it doesn't get too bad, you can just like let it dry, and that'll kind of it'll be okay. But if you keep working it too much, it's going to peel. And Bordeaux is actually too intense for what I'm doing, but that's okay. That's what these tests are for, right? To figure this out. Also, my hand resting on, you can really see it. My hand resting on the dress has picked up some of the dye / pigment, whatever they're using to make their markers. So that's something to keep in mind, because that can stain other areas of your art, or it can stain your clothing or fabrics like household furnishing. So if that is a concern for you, and maybe it should be, please keep that in mind, that your hand will pick up, because it's water-based, your hand will pick up the color and maybe transfer it. And I think I'm gonna use Bordeaux. Like, it's too intense in that. Oh, sorry. It's too intense in her neck, right? But I think I'm actually gonna use it to kind of shade, do shadows on the red of her headband. And shadows on her shoulder things, epaulettes, maybe that's the correct term for that. So something you can do for areas like that are a little too intense is you can bring them down with like a contrasting or a neutral color. And actually it's probably just going to make this like 100% worse. That's okay. That's what these tests are for me and you to figure this out together. And sometimes when things dry, like, look at how not pink her cheeks are. I'm going to actually go in and add a little more of the pink, because I like really rosy cheeks. I think they're very cute. And I might even do something I'm probably going to regret and add just a little bit of the salmon pink. And then just kind of blot it out. and some areas work a little better than others. Alright, so I've already gone ahead and put in the freckles, and her blush is looking so intense that it looks kind of like she has a black eye, which is, or like she got punched in the face, which isn't good. I can fiddle around with that a little bit and try to bring that color elsewhere, like dissipate it. And part of it is I had used that Bordeaux or Burgundy that I was telling you guys about that I said might not work. Well, I'd used it and it didn't work. So that's my fault, not the markers. And I added the freckles, and right now I'm just trying to kind of better distribute where the color is a little bit, since this doesn't, unlike with Copic markers, since it doesn't displace the ink, it can simply bring it to a different area that didn't have as much. This is a valid way to kind of bring color to different areas. So, we're almost done. We have the hair to do, and I'm putting in a base color of dark brown, which is actually a very light brown. Compared to, I think this is medium brown? No, it's just brown. But brown is lighter than dark brown. So, not only are the color names not really useful, but the cap isn't necessarily always indicative of the color inside. So that's something to keep in mind with these. And also, the digital swatch, and digital swatches are prone to, just not being really accurate. There's a lot of reasons why a digital swatch isn't going to work as well. It's just a color approximation, and it can vary based on like how well your monitor is calibrated, how well the company's the company that produces the products or produce the swatch, how well their monitors are calibrated, how well whether or not they did a physical swatch or they just approximated the color using like Photoshop. There's just a lot of reasons why it's a starting point, but it's not going to be the end all be all. And I'm letting the hair dry before I put other layers on by finishing the details on the dress. So what do you guys think? Do you have any experience using these? Do you use them dry? Do you use them as a watercolor marker? Are there any tips and tricks that I've missed that you'd like to share? Leave a comment and let me know. I'm always interested in learning new things, improving my game. These are also not comparing price to the Up and Up markers, but in general, these are some of the more affordable watercolor markers that are on the market. I recommend, if you're going to start a collection of these, I actually recommend going ahead and getting a big set so you don't have to try and track down colors you need later on. They're all there. I haven't crunched the numbers yet, so I can't tell you how much you save buying the big set, so it might not actually be worth it. I'm just speaking from like the annoyance of realizing I need more colors than what I purchased. and having to kind of look for them. So I am adding in a darker layer with good old regular brown. And it doesn't say regular brown on the side of the, it just says brown. And what's nice about this brush and the real brush that Kuratake Zig makes is you can make like pin flicks to make the hair streaks, the reflection in the hair. And my hands are kind of shaky tonight. It's dinner time. I'm ready to eat. I'll do this and maybe start dinner. Alright, so that just leaves a background, and her eye still kind of looks like she got punched. Sorry, Kara. Try to blend out this cheek a little bit with that lighter pink. And I need to select a color for the background, which I haven't done yet. You know, I guess I could use sap green, make this really look Christmas. So, since this is watercolor paper, and it's actually, I want to say like 140, 160 pound watercolor paper, it holds up to, and it's also pre-stretched, that's why it's not buckling or anything like that, because it is pre-stretched watercolor paper. It is gum bound, to the pad. It's like a gummy, tapey kind of binding. So that will help hold this in place. And if you're into Zentangles, Fluid makes square blocks in, 6x6 and 8x8. So the combination might be really good for you of these markers on the stretched watercolor paper at that size if you enjoy coloring your creations or want to watercolor in your creations. And I'm having trouble blending this sap green, which is a very dark sap green actually. I'm having trouble blending it out as much as I would like. And I mean, that's kind of my own fault because I wanted it a lot more subtle. And it's just kind of an intense color in this instance. Sap green is usually a lot lighter. And maybe I shouldn't have done sap green. My color choices were kind of limited because the 12 pack set is all bright. It, to me, they're all bright colors. They're not colors I naturally gravitate towards. And that seems to be the case for starter packs, is it's always seems like they think their audience is very young. Needs one of every color. And I don't like to render that way. sorry if I'm being kind of quiet. I'm hungry and I actually got some frustrating news via email. I can't talk about it, unfortunately. It's work related. I probably should have slept. I responded, and it wasn't like a sassy response, but I probably should have slept on it because I agreed to do more than is really fair to me. But I'm just kind of ready for this project to be in the can. It was supposed to be finished before Noka's Fest, and it hasn't. It isn't. You can't see. Sorry. I would really like it to be finished before Christmas, and it's like mid-November, and there's a good chance that's not gonna happen. Technically, it was supposed to be finished before ALA, but that was just like nobody's fault. It's just it was taking, it's watercolor, so it was taking a little while. Illustrations were added, that kind of thing. So this looks kind of dirty and gross. I might try to blend it out more with, boy, when did that happen? That's like really bad. That's like it's from my hand, I bet. See, I told you guys about that, about the ink possibly transferring, and it did, so. Case closed. I might actually cheat and go in with a water brush and try to smooth some of this out, because I just can't smooth it out. It's like you're scrubbing. Can't smooth it out with the little koi blender. So if you do larger images, this might not be the way you want to use these markers, because you may end up with, like, it looks dirty because it's not a clean application. I might regret that. I'll do it on camera so you guys can see how it works, if it fails or if it wins. All about sharing my failures with you guys, I guess. Like there to be more successes, but don't always get to pick. So today I bit the bullet and I bought myself a 6-month subscription to Snackbox. And my mom has been asking me a lot what I want for Christmas, and I couldn't really answer. I finally told her I want another Art Snacks subscription, because I'd like to see how the two services stack up. So I'm kind of thinking about putting those reviews on when I know I've been talking about doing the Patreon for a while. And I meant to make November my month, and it might still be my month. I might do it still this month. But I had trouble getting beta readers for Kara, and now that's, like, ready to move forward. And I just got bad news from this other job I have, so that has to be handled. And I probably opened up Pandora's box on that one. Because I was pretty much like, and if you have any other changes you need, this is the time to do it, because I'm not doing any more of them later, because we've done so many revisions on this thing. Like, it's not moving because of like constantly going back and forth. She'll okay something and then she'll change her mind months down the road. And I like, I want this to be a good project too. So I'll go and change it for her. And I mean, really, she should have said so at all of the other stages I sent her stuff at. And I kind of think she just doesn't check when I send her images. But that's gonna take doing, so that's a thing that has to be taken care of. Alright, so that's what it looks like right now. I have just enough water in my water brush. Okay, so when you add the colorless blender, you can't go over it with water. Like, it's pretty stable. I can get a little bit of movement. So what? The hair started to melt because I didn't go over that with colorless blender. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna let this layer of water I am applying right now dry, and then I'm going to strategically add some of the sap green again, and then go over it so that it isn't so obvious where it like just quit applying. All right, so let that dry. Alright, so since my house is nice and toasty by my own choice, my paper is nice and dry, and I can start trying to make some of those corrections with the water. And I realize that this is cheating a little bit because it does not want to move, because this is supposed to be a dry test. And maybe I'm being punished for this now, because now the green is really dark and it doesn't really want to move. There we go. And I'm just trying to even out the color in the background without tearing up the paper too much by going over it too many times. And something else you can do is if you encounter this sort of a problem, the water is actually helping. As you can see here, it's a little more even in tone than it is on the other side, where it's like there's very much a difference between the two areas. Something else you can do is you can use a white color pencil, softer the better, and just kind of run it over the area. Your intention isn't to like whiten it up so much as it is to break up where you last applied marks. Ah, nuts! It's leaking. Hooray. I was like, why am I not getting any water? Because it's leaking out the wrong side. I'm gonna have to grab a napkin. Give me a second. also probably, let's find out, you can probably pick up, you can pick up a little bit of color too if you over applied, if you are over zealous in your application. As you can see, it's still not as green over here as it could be. I mean, I could just like make it just like nothing but sap green. That would make it as green as it could be. But when doing this kind of stuff, patience can really help you, revisiting things, letting them dry, reevaluating. It can really make a big difference. Also, for whatever reason, the colorless blender that comes with that you can get for your Koi watercolor markers, it desaturates the color. It doesn't necessarily water it down so much as it makes it gray, which also makes it look kind of dirty, because you're not getting pure color, you're getting whatever is making the color less vibrant. So using water really shows you how different it can look, how much more vibrant it can look. Muddy, I think muddy was the word I was looking for. Definitely looks more like Christmas than it did with all the red and green. Maybe that's just because it's November and I'm thinking about Christmas right now, I guess. Kind of, a little bit. Mostly getting presents for other people. I know I'm one of those people who can be really hard to buy for, so I don't know where I was going with that. Other than, like, I guess I feel I don't necessarily have like grandiose, like some people like really count on Christmas, I guess. And I think if I were in more dire straits, Christmas would definitely be when I got all my art supplies and stuff. More dire straits. If I had less income, it might be a different income or a different profession. Christmas would be like when I would ask for art supplies. But even that, I mean, you know, if you don't know what you're looking for, it can be really daunting. So I write Christmas gift guides. I'm working on some for the blog, so if you're looking for ideas for an artist in your life, or for yourself, stuff to ask for, you should check them out. I have a Copic one that's coming up at the end of the month, so it should be coming in soon, and I'm still working on my comic artist one. Alright, so that's that's a little bit better, although now the green is like day glow green compared to the rest. But that was me using Sakura Koi markers dry for the most part, I hope that helped you guys make a decision one way or the other as to whether or not Sakura Koi watercolor markers are right for you. I'm Becca Hilburn, and I hope you guys have a good day. Bye!